So please welcome the president of Wärtsilä Marine, Mr. Roger Holm.
Thank you, and good morning also from my side. I'm really excited to be here, and I have to admit this is my first time here, not for the company but for me personally. But I have to say I've heard so many good things about what happens here and the business that is made here, so I'm really looking forward to today. We'll talk a bit about the future and the future trends that we see, but my point is also that I think the future is closer than we think in many ways, and that we can then debate during the day what this means. And we have many trends leading us towards lower emissions and what we call here towards a zero emission smart marine ecosystem. Before I go into that one, just briefly about the angle we look upon this one. Wärtsilä has developed a lot during the years and really growing from, in some places where we are still known as an engine business, but we do everything from the bridge down to the power and propulsion side and things in between. We are present in about 90 countries, and we are really proud to have more than 130 nationalities working as our colleagues around the globe. And this brings also a lot of insights and diversity into our business. A few years back, we were thinking a lot internally with this whole organization that what is the purpose of our company? What is it that we want to do? And we restated our purpose to enable sustainable societies with smart technology. And you will see that a lot in what we are trying to do. And we are operating in two businesses, the marine business, which I will come back to, but the same goes for the land-based energy business. So towards 100% renewable energies also on energy side. We see same trends in both businesses. They go a bit in different cycles and different speed, but there are a lot of similarities. If you need to go for solar and wind, for example, you need balancing power. You need to talk about different kind of fuels. You need to look at what's the fuel availability. Sounds familiar also for the marine side, and we are having the same discussion as well for the marine side. That's about Wärtsilä. Now I will go to the marine trends that we see from our side at the moment. If we look at the fuel bill of marine, more than 100 billion euros annually, and look at the same time that we transport, say around 90% of the world's goods is moved at some point in time with ships. Greenhouse gas emissions is between 2 and 3% from shipping. Shipping today is already today clearly the most environmental friendly way to move goods. And here we have also an opportunity for the future to get that more out in general public. How are we using this as also branding for shipping in general? Having said that, even if it's the most environmental friendly way to move goods today, we have looked a lot at different shipping segments and the opportunities that lies within optimizing. And we still have a lot of opportunities in looking how we can do shipping differently with new technologies, with cooperation, and as was said before, a lot by working together. This will not be done by one company or one entity or even by one regulator. It will be done by working together in many different parts. If we then look at the targets set by IMO for 2050 to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions by half, this is an enormous undertaking, but also an enormous opportunity if we look upon it. And let's remember now, to achieve that for the whole fleet, it means that probably on a vessel level, we need to take down the greenhouse gas emissions by, say, around 70% to be on a fleet level comparison of half. And at the same time, every single projection we have, we see a big fleet growth. You can then debate which one of these will happen, but every single projection says that we will have a fleet growth. This is why we need to come down to 70% on the total. And remember now, this sounds extremely far away, but we are already designing ships that will be in use 2050. So which will be part of this calculation? Here we will look at fuels, we will look at different technologies, we will look at different connectivities. And for sure we will see a lot of more different types of fuels in the future as well. We need to have more flexibility in the system. But to also assume that suddenly we will turn over the whole mass of shipping to a new fuel in a fast way, that's to talk about something that is almost impossible. Year 2000 we had the first LNG-powered vessel, if we forget the LNG carriers. And we still talk about an extremely small penetration of the whole fleet. So the change to go to a new fuel with distribution chain availability technology, and you can add on more to these ones, it's an enormous effort for the whole shipping community. And this is also why we believe that the LNG will play a key role for the shipping to achieve these targets. If you would flip the whole fleet today, if that would be possible, you would save maybe 15% of the greenhouse gas emissions end to end. So that's only one part of it. Then we also believe that the connectivity technology will play another double-digit role here. How much it is, that's still to be seen. In some segments, like container vessels, we believe it's much more. And then you might see other segments where it's much less. But the key point here for us is that we need to see much more cooperation. And we believe this is already happening. It's happening among competitors, it's happening among different players. We launched an initiative last year that we call Oceanic Awakening. And what we try to do here is to get other stakeholder involved, meaning big port cities. And I'll show you a short video that we used as part of that launch.
The future's not what it used to be. The city was a place you could be sure of getting work. People flocked here by the millions. The promise of a better life. Fast forward to your parents' time. Building a home and raising a family. And as you grew, so did the city, with waves of change. Our lifestyles evolved. The things that excited us, the way we consume, faster. Faster. But the city wasn't built to grow like this, and the cracks started to show. Resources stretched to breaking point. Weight buckling the foundation. Our imagined future, a fading mirage. A broken city. Broken dream. Change needs to come. The city's problems can be solved on the ocean. The environment depends on it. Infrastructure depends on it. Our children's quality of life depends on it. Our journey with the sea is just beginning. It's time for a worldwide awakening on an oceanic scale.
Our target with Oceanic Awakening was to gather more stakeholders in the discussion, and especially targeting big port cities. And so far we have had a lot of discussion around these ones. We have more cities that are targeting to join us on this path. So far we have, for example, Hamburg, we have Rotterdam that have joined, and our target is that over time this C20 initiative will develop by itself by the stakeholders. This should not be a Wärtsilä initiative or any single company initiative. Every projection you look at shows that the share of people in the future living in major cities is just growing. It means also that we need to look at the total infrastructure, not the shipping part of itself, but also how does it work together with the ports? And what's the role of the port in this infrastructure? And if we talk about connectivity, this is the part also where we need to discuss with the counterpart on the shore side. These are extremely more long-term targets. Let's move more into what we see today and a bit about the connectivity and what we call smart marine in action. We can list all kind of nice technology words that doesn't actually mean anything. We are very good at it, including ourselves, and as long as we can't show any value of these technology words, why do it? Our point is that how quickly can we turn this technology into business value? And the change will not happen in one go, and it will not be a big change. It will come in bits and pieces. And this part we already see happening. So to say that this will take 10 years to happen, I don't believe so. It's already happening, but it's happening in small steps. And the reason is that the technology is there. Most of what we are talking about today is there as a technology. The big challenge is how do we connect it together? We have a whole world that is built up in silos, both when we design, construct, and operate a vessel, how it operates with different parties. It's built up for a world where you shouldn't share anything. Now I'm a bit too black and white, I know that, but that's also what's holding us back. It's not necessarily the technology. And the good point when talking about connectivity is that we should target to reduce the fuel bill, so we should save money. That should take down the emission. And we can also create safer environment, because the technology we are using is about also creating more safety. I used to compare it, definitely the right place to mention that I drive a hybrid Volvo. It's like the hybrid Volvo where you have the autopilot on and it decides where you drive on the battery or the engine or helps you with the steering. That's the simplified way of trying to say that what do we want to achieve here. And all the technology, the big parts are already there. One example of cooperation. This was started last year and has been run into this year. This is very much looking into the far future. And when you look at the companies involved, you are coming from a lot of different industries, interests, and so on. But when these teams work together and looking at the opportunities to go to a zero-emission energy distribution at sea, you couldn't see the difference in background. Yes, you might debate that we are still far away to have this happening, but when we put together the different companies to look at the opportunities, it was not like we have different strategies or different visions of where we are going. That was not the difficult part at all. So I think this is a great example which was launched at Nor-Shipping to show what can we do when we start working together. Then looking at other parts of the technology and what we can do already today, we have already done auto-docking. This Folgefonn vessel in Norway has gone between three ports without the captain touching anything. So that technology is also there. We are doing what we call the IntelliTug with Port of Singapore, which is not about taking away the captain at all. It's about using technology to make life safer and easier and more efficient for the operation. So to use the same situational awareness technology, warn about what's going to happen in the surroundings, do some autonomous operations, and use that to the benefit of how we operate safely in the harbor. This is heavily driven by Port of Singapore. And they are definitely a front runner also in taking in new technologies. In general, I believe this is also what we should look at in the total picture. Some while back there was a lot of talks about unmanned vessels. The target is not as such to have an unmanned vessel. The target is to use technology to again save fuel, less emissions, and have safer operations. Yes, maybe then in some applications you might end up not having a captain on board, but the main benefit of using technology is to save and optimize. Again, if I go back to my Volvo example, I'm a more efficient driver if I see how what's the economy of it. If I put on the autopilot, it's even one step more. I can never beat the autopilot. The same technology we should use here to one information is one step to automate it and help the crew on board. That's the next step. Because the data points that we will use to have the optimal route, to use the power production on board in the best optimal way, and to know when we should arrive at port, all these combinations, and partly which are changing all the time, we can do a big step by having the information available. But the next step is coming when you automate it and you help the crew on board to do that. An example from Sweden, which is a very recent one. This is a hybrid tug from Port of Luleå that just has been taken into use. This is with our hybrid technology, which we see more and more coming as well. So a bit referring to my Volvo again, same technology, but on a ship. And the key point is to integrate it, to integrate the battery, the engine, and the automation to work in an efficient way together. So why do we believe this is the direction? Two examples. This is a 5,500 TEU container ship traveling for 3.5 days. The white curve is the real power usage. And I think some here, the port arrival time was changed. And you see that, yes, they reacted, and then they are still having a lot of waiting time. You might claim this is an extreme case. Maybe it is to some extent, but it's a real case. We see different dissimilarities. In this, if you would have fully automated, a bit going back to the optimization, we could have saved 1/3 around of the power usage. I know this is different in different segments. You cannot generalize. And the benefits and the opportunities are also very different. For us, where we see the new technology coming in the most at the moment is in the cruise segments. The cruise owners are today pushing heavily to have this full integration of everything on the ship, also what's happening in the port side. Same technology, of course, can be applied then in other different segments. Coming back then to here, money and emissions going hand in hand. Another angle why I believe this also will be pushed for, if you take Port of Singapore, let's just assume that you look at the last 74 hours, half of the ships would have this full technology, so you would arrive just on time to Port of Singapore for the last part of the journey. This is what you would save. Of course, that would mean that every single vessel is fully connected and have that data flow with each port it's going to. We talk about a lot of money and a lot of emission reductions. Then we can debate why is this not done already. It's too good to be true when you look at the figures. It goes back to the challenges we have with sharing data, having data available, how even standardized it is. But from our point of view, the discussion is not if this will happen. It will happen. The discussion is when and how. Of course, this is a dream world in a way, you might say. But already if we would get us halfway, that's enough of opportunities to do something significant. And it goes back to also the driving forces. Is it only going to be IMO driving on the environmental agenda, or will it be further pushed by the general consumer? And how much will that then impact the decisions we take? We sincerely believe that the maritime can be a catalyst for a better tomorrow. We should be more bold about saying we are already the most environmental friendly way to move goods. If you look at the big picture, and if you look at what everyone needs today and what we're doing, it's already something that is doing well. And we have so many opportunities to even further develop that image of shipping. So let's work together, let's make sure we utilize the technology that is already today, and by cooperating we can also be here some years from now and say that actually this was even faster than we ever thought. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Roger Holm, main sponsor Wärtsilä. What contributed you to be the main sponsor this year?
I think it was a lot that we heard before, that it's the intimate feeling of this event. To be honest, and some that know me know that I'm not that fan of big exhibitions and where you have huge stands. It doesn't give this intimate feeling that I think you have here, and what I've heard a lot about. I think that's a key issue, that if you get too big, you mostly talk to your competitors as an exhibition. That tells you that something is wrong. And I what I've at least heard about this is definitely not the case here, so I'm really looking forward to this.
So Katarina Norén, she has been here before, but this is actually your first time
here.
It is,
yes.
So what is your expectations from Dunsu Shipping Meet now?
A lot of dialogue, a lot of discussions, a lot of this intimate feeling. I compare to an other recent, which I would call even an intimate exhibition as well in its own field, is Sea Trade in Miami, which is for the cruise industry. You walk around and you all the time talk with customers, and you have this dialogue about how can we do things, in how can we cooperate, how can we, what's the next stage, and so on. I have a feeling this is exactly the same.
That sounds very good. Mm. And you also, like Katarina did, she said this word together and cooperating, and that might follow us those 2 days, I think so. So once again, thank you, Roger Holm, for this opening seminar and for your main sponsor to Dunsu Shipping Meet 2019. And
thank
warm
you.
Applause.
Thank you very much. Thank you.